The next 30 minutes, I'll try to present but a rough account about when and how my country entered the computer era. Should I exceed the time, our chairman can stop me at any point, because you will find a complete and more detailed account on the proceeding of this workshop that will be published by IT Star Press. Is correct? Okay. So, until 1954, only a handful of Italian mathematicians and engineers had the privilege of some insight and hands-on acquaintance with stored program electronic computers. On the occasion of study missions at the most renowned pioneering installation in the United Kingdom and especially the United States. At the same time, no one of such technological marvels, the computer, was still available throughout the country. But in a few months, encompassing 1954 and 55, four far-reaching initiatives bloomed at almost the same time. Two different approaches, buy or make a computer, were viable to fill the gap, and both were actually pursued. The Polytechnic of Milano acquired in the USA, a CRC computer to equip the just then set up Centro di Calcoli Numerici, Numerical Computation Center. The machine was running by October 1954, and the center officially opened some months later. In Rome, the National Research Council bought in UK Ferranti Mark I Star for the Istituto Nazionale per le Applicazioni del Calcolo, in brief ENAC. The FINAC machine, and FINAC is a contraction of Ferranti ENAC, arrived in Rome in November 1954 and completed acceptance test on June 1955. This is the machine of the Polytechnic of Milano. A small size but very cleverly engineered computer, and you see at the center the drum memory, sorry. And the next figure, you see a photo, and the you have this machine is still preserved at the Polytechnic of Milano. And this is a photo of the Ferranti Mark I, taken in 56. Yeah. Why Polytechnic of Milano and ENAC choose the approach, embrace the buy approach? Simply because, simply in order to have quickly available and up-to-date and powerful tool to afford computing problems whose solution was massively required, arising from the most varied needs of industry, engineering, physics, economy, and mathematics itself. Such was, after all, the institutional missions they had, these two institutes had to fulfill day by day. Worthy of mention that both acquisitions were almost entirely supported by ERP funds, the American European Recovery Program, better known as Marshall Plan, as has been mentioned in a preceding speech. An even more important common trait of the two initiatives appears when appreciating how to buy a computer really meant in that period. Far from being a ready-to-use product, the computer required in-house hardware maintenance and upgrades, often implying design and construction of original supplementary features. Moreover, the machine were shipped nude, yet this means lacking of any software aid. Software development thus became the most impelling and demanding concern. Service and utility programs, the forerunners of operating systems, algorithm for vector and arrays handling, libraries of subroutine for recurring problems like mathematical function calculation. Until users themselves build up their own loaders, interpreters, and assembler-like symbolic languages, software had to be coded in machine language. And all these hardware and software tasks and duties visibly reduced the often overestimated distance between buying and making a computer. As a further consequence, such in-house activities concerned in the first moment the particular machine owned by the user, but evolved very soon into a generalized approach to almost every branch of computer science. Already mentioned simultaneity of the four initiatives did not imply any underlying overall strategy, but clearly indicates that the urgency to enter the computer era was widely perceived throughout the country. As a very fruitful consequence, the efforts went through distinct courses, which complemented one each other, avoiding competitive or conflicting situations. Also resting on mutually independent scopes and resources, several kinds of collaboration were set up since the beginning. As a matter of fact, computing centers at Milano and Roma, together with Pisa and Olivetti Laboratories, became the incubators for the first generation of Italian informaticians. Yes, according to the MAKE approach, ultimate tangible goals lasted several years, even if the intermediate phases were full of scientific, technological, and educational achievements. The University of Pisa established his Centro Studia, Center Study for Electronic Computer Calculators, with the aim of designing and built the Calcolatrice Elettronica Pisana, CP in acronym, a scientific computer. And the activities of the center started in March 1955. The organization that followed the MAKE approach was the international renowned firm Olivetti. The firm Olivetti decided to enter the then emerging computer industry. His laboratory for electronic research was then established at Barbagina, nearby Pisa, in order to design and prototype the ELEA commercial mainframe. And research and development began at mid-1955. And Olivetti headquarters were located in a small town in Ivrea. Worthwhile noting that the University of Pisa, on the contrary of the Rome and Milan institution, the Politecnico di Milano and the ENAC Institute, didn't have a traditional concern with scientific computing, and the CEP, Calcolatrice Elettronica Pisana project, originated from rather fortuitous as well as fortunate circumstances. A consortium of local governments had made available quite wealthy funds in order to foster some substantial scientific undertaking in the Tuscany region. Upon an authoritative suggestion by Enrico Fermi, the 1939 Nobel laureate for physics, the construction of a powerful electronic computer was chosen. And an ad hoc CRC center was committed to manage such an unprecedented undertaking. An interim prototype called the Reduced Machine, Macchina Ridotta, was ready as early as 1957, And despite its restriction, its usage revealed to be quite fruitful. Official opening of CAP, completed machine, lasted instead in until November 1961, even if it was running well before on a rather uncertain provisional ground. This is the reducer machine built in Pisa and working by 1957. This is the completed computer, and the lower photograph shows the machine still preserved at the Museum of Computing Instruments in Pisa. Let's turn now to the Olivetti adventure, which is a substantial part of my speech. You know perhaps that the firm Olivetti was established in 1988, at the beginning of the century, by Camillo Olivetti, who set up a small typewriter factory in Ivrea, a town near Torino. Along 3 decades, the business grew at a steady rate on domestic and foreign markets, until Adriano, the eldest son of the founder, succeeded in 1938 when he was 37. Under his clever and resolute leadership, Ivrea's enterprise undertook a substantial upwards jump that became particularly fruitful during the post-war years, making Olivetti a multinational holding and a leader in the worldwide market of office equipment. New plants were built in Italy and abroad, Spain, Germany, UK, Mexico, Brazil, Argentina. An efficient worldwide commercial network was established. Mechanical calculators and accounting machines flanked the traditional typewriters as a flag product. New products were developed, like teletypes, office steel furniture, and precision machine tool. And the establishment, as mentioned before, in 1965 of the electronic development laboratory was anything but an abrupt decision. It was instead the first move of a strategy that Adriano Olivetti matured over the post-war years. Electronics, on his mind, never represented a departure from the traditional and successful business of office equipment. His long-sighted vision conceived, in fact, the electronic computer, better to say, the electronic data processor, as the core of the office of the future. And looking in retrospect, the soundness of such an early intuition is proved by the trend actually observed in Italy over the period 55-65. This histogram testifies the explosion of the market in terms of quantity, as well as the decline of scientific users. You see the situation in 65, and while at the beginning computers were all dedicated to scientific work, in 65 they represented only 9% of the market share. Of course, the replacement of punched card data processing with electronic computing significantly contributed, not only in Italy, to speed up the growth in number of computer installation. IBM, of course, dominated the market, but IBM activity in Italy was not only commercial. They also had production plants for small computer systems. Let me recall the IBM 360 Model 20 and later the IBM System 3, the machine with the small cards, punched cards. And IBM had research center as well. Adriano Olivetti, the leader of the company, was perfectly conscious that a strong scientific and technological groundwork was the prerequisite to afford the computer market with an original and competitive product. He therefore welcomed and fostered the opportunity of joining the still then starting initiative at the University of Pisa that I mentioned before. The already mentioned laboratory to build the CEP scientific computer. After a period of friendly collaboration, the university and Olivetti signed a formal agreement. The CEP project then started under the directorship of the physicist Marcello Conversi and on the ground of a learned survey on the worldwide state of the art prepared by Alfonso Caracciolo, together with an overall project plan bringing a reliable estimate of duration, manpower and expenditure prepared by Mario Chu of Olivetti, who acted as an interim technical director of the CEP project. Here you can see Roberto Olivetti, the son of Adriano, to which the same Adriano committed a special care for the electronic activities of the Olivetti. And Mario Chu was deserves a special attention because until his untimely death, he represented the driving force of Olivetti's activities in the domain of electronics. Mario Chu belonged to an Italo-Chinese family, and he was born in Roma and was educated entirely in Italian school. And Adriano Olivetti, whoever had the ability of immediately perceive and evaluate people's personality, met him, Mario Chu, during a trip in the United States when he was a 30 years old professor at Columbia University and was touched by his human and professional traits. Within a few months, in 54, Chu was hired by Adriano, who charged him with the twofold responsibility to contribute to the start of the Pisa scientific early initiatives and to set up the Olivetti Laboratory for Research and Electronics, the already mentioned Laboratory for Electronic Research. According to Adriano's intuition, Chu emerged as an excellent manager as well as a resolute but friendly leader of the laboratory team, a small group of young engineers and physicists carefully selected by him. And this is the first, I have already mentioned that the laboratory was established near Pisa in a locality named Barbaricina. And this group of young engineering scientists became known as the Barbaricina guys. Even if the university, the initiatives of the University of Pisa and Olivetti shared the courageous make approach, I ought to point out some intrinsic difference between the two projects. First of all, before the advent of the general purpose computers, the architecture of a scientific machine markedly departed from that of a business-oriented one. As a further difference, while the CEP, the Pisa machine, was intended as a one-of-a-kind machine to be used in a single laboratory-like location, the Olivetti computer was conceived as an industrial product. It had, therefore, to fulfill specific needs of mass production as well as business of maintenance, ergonomy, and aesthetic appeal as well. Last but not least, CEP Pisa project was carried on in the style of an open contribution to the advancement of science, thus originating a flash of papers detailing scientific and technical achievements. Olivetti's policy, according to common practice in industrial research, privileged instead confidentiality, so that articles and reports, anyway of more or less promotional scope, appeared only in the latest phase of the project. This is the final result of the laboratory of for electronic research. It was a very successful computer, a big one computer, first delivered in 1959. Subsequent year, 35 machines were sold. One of these machines is preserved in Tuscany by an high school, the Enrico Fermi Technical Institute. And you can see the notable design by a well-known industrial designer, the architect Ettore Sozzas. And two prototypes were completed in 1967, based on vacuum tube, on valve technology. But Chu insisted that Olivetti had to afford the market with a leading edge product, and insisted to adopt the new transistor technology, and so that the circuitry had to be redesigned completely, saving only the functional and logical project. And the first machine was delivered to a customer in 59. Here you can see, I don't know if you can read. Anyway, you have a comparison between some characteristics of the machine I mentioned until here. You can see, for instance, the main memory. You go through the CRC, the machine of the Polytechnic of Milan had 100 words. The FINAC words, 800 words. The ELEA Olivetti had a magnetic core memory ranging from a minimum of 20,000 characters up to 160,000. The CP had or you can see for instance the addition per second. Here are 100, 1,000, 5,000, and about 7,000, and so on. Or the instruction set, that is the number of native instruction available in machine language, from 25, 30, 91, so that the programming was even more versatile and easy. But all this came to an end because this industrial adventure of Olivetti, because the Olivetti incurred in very serious financial difficulties. And the solution was to sell the Divisione Elettronica Olivetti to the American of General Electric. General Electric in this period, we are speaking of 65, was seeking throughout Europe for occasion to improve his computer business in Europe. And almost contemporary to the to the acquisition of Olivetti Divisione Elettronica, acquired the French Bull, la Compagnie de Machines Bull, which that had in the same period the same financial difficulties. But while in France the selling to the historical firm Bull was felt like a national a wound to the national pride. In Italy, the government ignore completely the damage to lose such a strategic asset. And in France, in fact, the President de Gaulle launched the celebrated Plan Calcul. Anyway, the Divisione Elettronica were sold. Of course, Olivetti continued to flourish for several years on the base of the traditional mechanical production. But the story was not concluded because many other machines built, designed and built in Italy were very successful on the international markets. And especially notable, the Pier Giorgio Perotto and a small group of his collaborators did not follow the General Electric but remained in Olivetti and invented the what we can consider to some extent the first personal computer of the world, the Olivetti Programma 101, with over 40,000 machines sold. And which had, it was a, not a toy, but a real computer with a programming language, simple but very effective. And particularly a floppy disk card. A card was reverse, the black reverse is the magnetic sensitive side. And this feature was copied, cloned by the HP, Hewlett-Packard, who paid about $1 million of royalties in order to use this. And the last is Federico Faggin, you know, the inventor, co-inventor with Ted Hoff of the microprocessor in 1961, the celebrated Intel 4004. And Federico Faggin began his career in exactly in Olivetti, and then migrated in a first time at Fairchild and then at Intel. Thank you.